Hi, very good morning. I'm Dr. Janak Patel. I'm a general physician. Today we'll be talking about one of the very, very useful topic, and you will be using that particular molecule every day. So you must know regarding how to use, when to use, how much to give, how long to give, when to stop, all those things. So I'm going to talk about what we call as antibiotics. So we'll be talking under the heading Introduction, Antibiotics, Golden Rules, Disease and Selections. We'll be having a separate discussion on what we call as related to fever. Now, antibiotics are also sometimes included in antimicrobial therapy, or you can call them as anti-infective agents. And you know very well, it is a deadly weapon. Used properly, it is useful, advantageous. If not used properly, it can be dangerous for the person in whom you are using and also for the society. Basically, we want to use the antibiotic to have a cure in a disease which is caused by a microorganism. While using that particular drug, you are going to have some side effects, and we call as some little dangerous side effects, we call that as toxicity. You know very well, sepsis is due to microbial agents, and that can be lethal. At the same time, misuse of antibiotic can give rise to resistance, and that resistant organism can be dangerous for the society. Because of sepsis, you can end up with... Hello? Ah, Mannu, mummy na phone upar kar. Hun atyar pehlu lecture nu taiyar karu chu. Okay, okay. So it can ends up with MODS. So it is called multi-organ dysfunction syndrome, and it is lethal. At the same time, because of use of some antibiotics, you can end up with anaphylaxis. You can end up with SJ syndrome, we call Stevens-Johnson syndrome. You can end up with Jerricks-Herx-Hammer reaction. In a case of leprosy, you can end up with lepra reaction. If you don't treat a person with sepsis, he can end up with death. And here also, because of these reactions, because of toxicity, person can end up with death also. So on both sides, it is a very delicate thing, and you have to decide. So you have to always consider risk and benefit ratio. Risk as far as infection is concerned is sepsis, MODS and death, which is lethal for the person. On the same time, using an antibiotic, you can end up with toxicity, resistance, different dangerous side effects, and you can also end up with death because of misuse of antibiotic. So you have to decide between risk and benefit ratio. If the benefit is more, indications. If risk is more, it becomes contraindications. And indirectly, you can consider antibiotic as a chemical weapon. And any chemical weapon, you have to use with caution. The word antibiotic has come from anti means against, bios means life. So it is a substance which is derived from natural substances. And that will kill the bacteria and will prevent the growth of microorganisms, but does not seriously harm the person. Ideally, this is called as antibiotic. But depending upon the antibiotic, it can kill the bacteria as well as it can give rise to serious side effects in a person. And that you have to take care. Now, there are a good number of antibiotics which are synthetically prepared, which are not derived from natural substances like fungus, bacteria, etc. So they are synthetic preparations. So, and This is the one of the most common prescribed drug in entire world. So, also called as antimicrobial agent, means the substance which acts on microbial. So, any microorganism it acts, it is called as antimicrobial agents. And that particular substance will kill or inhibit the growth of microorganism. And this microorganism includes bacteria, fungi, protozoa. When you want to kill bacteria, the drug what you use we call as antibacterial, or we call antibiotics. While the drug which is acting on a fungus only, we call antifungal, antiprotozoal, like that. So antibacterial agent kills or inhibits the growth of bacteria, and this usually we label as antibiotic. Now these are all the different microorganisms from which we derive these antibiotics. You can see this. These are gram-positive rods. These are actinomycosis, actinomycetes, fungi. So from that fungi you can get cephalosporin groups, griffepulvin, penicillin. From gram-positive road, bacitracin, polymyxin. So these are the antibiotics which we derive. There are some which will be acting on fungus. There will be some which will be acting on a bacteria itself. So depending upon, these are natural substances, natural materials we call as a microorganism which are there in a atmosphere. And from there you derive these particular substances. These are all the different. Bacitracin, polymyxin, amphotericin, chloramphenicol, erythromycin, neomycin, streptomycin, gentamicin, cephalosporin group, cephalothin, griffepulvin, penicillin, etc. The first which was derived was penicillin. Now, that's why, depending upon where it is acting, on which substance it is acting more, we use those particular words. We either use the word anti-infective, antimicrobial or antibiotics. Antibiotic means acting on a microorganism. Particularly, we use the word bacteria. If it is acting on a mycobacterium, we call it as AKT, anti-tubercular treatment. Acting on a virus only, we call antiviral. On a fungus, antifungal. Parasites, antiparasites. Acting on a helminth, antihelminthic. There are some chemical materials which are acting on a multiple things, say like rifampicin. It is acting on a mycobacterium, it is also acting on a microorganism also. So that is rifampicin. Metronidazole will act on a parasites, also will act on a bacteria also. On bacteria also. Metronidazole, tinidazole, onidazole. Doxycycline will have effect on a parasites. Even it will have an effect on what we call as spirochetes. It will have also effects on bacteria. It will also have an effect in case of what we call as rickettsia, etc. Same way, levofloxacillin, moxifloxacillin, ofloxacillin can have effect on mycobacterium as well as bacteria. So some drugs can have an effect on multiple different types of microorganisms. So you should know where they are acting, etc. These are all antiviral drugs, amantadine, remantadine, acyclovir. There are some other materials called interferon which is also acting on a virus. So there are different types of antiviral drugs. Now you are aware of it, they are utilized in COVID-19. These are antiprotozoals, metronidazole, pyrimethamine, suramine, etc. Most commonly utilized is metronidazole, tinidazole, ornidazole, secnidazole, etc. Those are different antiprotozoal we call. Antihelminthic, mainly mebendazole, albendazole and ivermectin. These are the two common groups which are very commonly being utilized. And there is another compound which calls a niclosamide. That is also utilized as an antihelminthic. So you've got antifungals. These are all different antifungals which are being there at present in market. And there are many more which are in market. You know, viral infection can involve brain, pharynx, It can produce sinus involvement, sinuses, cardiovascular system, liver, skin, eye, parotid gland, respiratory system, what we call as spinal cord, GI tract, and even in case of a sexually transmitted disease. So there are a lot of virus which can involve multiple organs. So you have to think of which organ is involved and what is the possible virus. And that we are not going to discuss in detail. It is very clear that viral infection, some of the common viral infection which you will see in your everyday practice is common cold, hepatitis, mumps, measles, rubella, and chickenpox. And the reappearance, recurrence of varicella, we call as a herpes zoster. And in that, antiviral drugs are effective, antibiotics do not work. So remember that any person who has got a viral infection, don't use antibiotic unless there is a supersedate by bacterial infection. Opposite of that, if a person who has got bacterial infection, like streptococcal throat infection, impetigo, pertussis, bacterial conjunctivitis, UTI, abscess, diabetic foot, etc., where antiviral drugs are not effective, antibiotics are effective. You have to find out which bacteria is involving that particular infection. We'll be going through some of the introductory part of different types of bacteria. There are gram-positive bacteria, gram-negative bacteria, anaerobic bacteria, which can be gram-positive, can be gram-negative, atypical bacteria, spirochetes, mycobacterium, etc. We'll be not talking about mycobacterium, we'll be talking mainly of these groups, atypical bacteria, etc. We'll not be talking about even spirochetes. In gram-positive, most common staphylococci, streptococci, and another group is enterococci. These are all subgroups in those particular. And staphylococci, streptococci, most common involvement is of a skin. And in case of an abscess, cellulitis, furuncle, carbuncle, etc., you will have staphylococci or streptococci. These are the two most common organisms which will be involving in those particular groups. While gram-negative organism, most common is E. coli, second common Klebsiella, Proteus, then even Salmonella, Shigella, Pseudomonas. Abdominal infection, nosocomial infection, most common E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, and Pseudomonas. Neisseria meningitis, most common in meningitis, particularly in children. While gonorrhea, Neisseria gonorrhea is most common in sexually transmitted disease. Campylobacterium is most common in GI tract infection. Helicobacterium pylori is most common in, again, GI tract, particularly responsible for what we call as a duodenal ulcer, most common. Vibrio cholera for cholera, H. influenza for respiratory tract infection. So you should be aware of this gram-negative organism, which organs they involve. So you must be aware of, these are odd organisms which are very rarely being found, but sometimes you may come across. But the most common E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, Pseudomonas, then we call GI tract involvement, respiratory involvement, H. influenza, upper respiratory tract and lower respiratory tract involvement. So these are some of the common organisms as far as gram-negative is concerned. Among anaerobic, gram-positive is Clostridium group. Clostridium difficilis is GI tract. Clostridium welchi, gas gangrene. Clostridium tetani, tetanus. And botulism is botulinum. So these are all Clostridium group, which are gram-positive anaerobic organisms. While gram-negative is Bacteriofragilis. This is an odd organism. Once in a while you come across and it can involve abdominal organs. Anaerobic gram-negative organism. Among atypical organisms, Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, Legionella, and Rickettsia. Rickettsia is not very common, but once in a while you can come across rickettsial infection also. Chlamydia, Mycoplasma, and Legionella are responsible for one of the most common is we call atypical pneumonias. And Chlamydia is also one of the organism which is responsible for what we call as acute coronary syndrome, plaque rupture due to inflammation. And that can be one of the organism responsible. It is found to be one of the organism responsible, Chlamydia. As far as spirochete is concerned, Trypanema palladium, this will be very common in, we call as a sexually transmitted infections. Leptospira is not very common, but once in a while you can come across also Leptospira. Mycobacterium you are aware of, we call as a Mycobacterium tuberculosis and Mycobacterium avium. And there is a second Mycobacterium which involves the skin part, we call as a leprosy. So these are, we are not going to talk in detail regarding that. These are the different organisms and these are the organs which are being involved. As we pass by, we'll be talking about all those organism and which organs they involve. Some of those we have already mentioned. Now we come to the main important part, we call as antibiotics. Now antibiotic, first we'll be talking about classification, what are the actions. Then we'll be talking about the metabolism of antibiotic itself, then indications, what dose, route of administration, durations, etc. in those particular groups. Antibiotic can be classified according to the chemical structures, mechanism of action, on which organism they act, what type of action they give, spectrum activity, narrow spectrum, broad spectrum, type of action, bactericidal, bacteriostatic, and from where they are derived, whether natural or from synthetic source. And depending upon the mechanism of action, depending upon the chemical structures, depending upon what type of organism they are acting, etc. So you can derive those particular name and you can give structural names. So according to the chemical structure, sulfonamides group, diaminopyrimidine groups, quinolones, beta-lactamase, tetracycline, nitrobenzene, aminoglycoside, macrolides. Some of those are also useful in leprosy. Say Dapsone is useful in leprosy. There is ciprofloxacillin, fluoroquinolones we call, quinolones, is useful in MDR tuberculosis, particularly now what are commonly being utilized. Moxifloxacillin, etc. You utilize trimethoprim or pyrimethamine along with sulfa in case of malaria. Resistant malaria, P. falciparum also. Beta-lactamase is also utilized in sexually transmitted infection. Doxycycline is also utilized in sexually transmitted infection, also in case of malaria, resistant malaria. So there are multiple use. Other groups include lincosamide, polypeptide antibiotic, glycopeptide, oxazolidine, nitrofuran, nitrimidazole, nicotinic acid derivatives, polyethylene antibiotic, azole derivatives, as well as miscellaneous group. So there are a lot of chemical groups depending upon which you will put them into a separate groups. Depending upon the mechanism of action, there are some antibiotic which inhibits the cell wall synthesis. That includes what we call as a penicillin cephalosporin groups, while which produces leakage from the cell membrane, polypeptide groups, which inhibits the protein synthesis, tetracycline, chloramphenicol, and we call erythromycin groups, and which acts on messenger RNA is aminoglycosides, streptomycin, gentamicin, we call as aminoglycoside groups. There are some which inhibits DNA, like fluoroquinolones. Some interferes with DNA functions, like rifampicin. Some interferes with DNA synthesis, antiviral drugs, which interfere with intermediate metabolism, like sulfonamides, pyrimethamine, ethambutol. These are all bacteriostatics. So some inhibit cell wall synthesis, some disrupt the membranes, some inhibit the protein synthesis, some are acting on anti-metabolites, and some are acting on RNA and DNA. So depending upon that, you classify. According to the mode of action, bacteriostatics, which inhibits the growth, and bactericidal, which kills the bacteria. There are some which are acting on one or two bacteria only, we call narrow spectrum. and some which are acting on multiple bacteria, we call broad spectrum. So these are some of the examples which are acting on a multiple. So this is an example of bacteriostatic, and this is the example of what we call as bactericidal. Bactericidal are vancomycin, fluoroquinolone, penicillin, aminoglycoside, cephalosporin, carbapenem, metronidazole, etc. While the bacteriostatic are erythromycin, clindamycin, sulfa, trimethoprim, tetracycline, chloramphenicol. These are bacteriostatic. Always bactericidal are better because they kill bacteria. While bacteriostatic, they inhibit the growth. So it is not going to kill the bacteria, sorry. So this is the importance. So bacteriostatic, commonest which we use in everyday practice is tetracycline, chloramphenicol, erythromycin, that is we call erythromycin, azithromycin, lincomycin. And bactericidals are what we call as commonest, cephalosporin, penicillin. So best is bactericidal drugs, aminoglycosides, fluoroquinolones. So they are bactericidal. But when you combine trimethoprim with sulfa, it becomes bactericidal. Bactericidal, cotrimoxazole. Our drugs which are having a very narrow spectrum is erythromycin, streptomycin, penicillin G. While the drugs which is having a very broad spectrum, tetracycline, chloramphenicol, etc. So penicillin has got only action on gram-positive organism. While you can see tetracycline, gram-negative, gram-positive, even chlamydia, rickettsia. While some antibiotic will have effect on selective, say streptomycin has got effect on mycobacterium as well as gram-negative organism also. And not much effect on gram-positive. So you have to decide which is a broad spectrum. Say tetracycline, gram-negative, gram-positive, chlamydia, rickettsia. While polymyxin, mainly on gram-negative. Isoniazide, mycobacterium only. Streptomycin, mycobacterium as well as gram-negative. So penicillin has got effect on gram-negative, gram-positive as well as chlamydia. So penicillin, tetracycline is little broad spectrum antibiotic. Locally acting, systemic acting. The drug which is not absorbed becomes locally acting. Say as for example, neosporin, framycetin. Those are locally acting. So they are very commonly utilized in the form of skin ointment, eye ointment, ear drops, eye drops, etc. So that you can prevent systemic side effects and you can have a local effects. While systemic, which can be absorbed very easily and it will have an effect on different tissues, cells, organs. So that will be systemic. Some antibiotic also has got an immune modulatory effects. Means even after the antibiotic is stopped, still the effect of antibiotic can be there because of immune modulation like macrolides, fluoroquinolones. These two are the most common which we are utilizing. So macrolides and fluoroquinolones, those are the two common. Now, little introduction regarding metabolism. This is very, very important because when you give an antibiotic, how fast it is metabolized, where it is metabolized, how it is absorbed, where it will be concentrated, it is quite useful. You should be aware of it. So depending upon how you are giving, it will be absorbed. Good number of antibiotic is absorbed from GI tract. Some antibiotic can be absorbed from oral mucosa, from stomach, small intestine. Some antibiotic can be easily absorbed from skin also, and they can have a systemic side effects. But the antibiotic which is not absorbed through the skin into systemic circulation, they will be useful in a local effects like skin ointments, particularly neosmycin, soframycin. While the antibiotic which can be given intramuscular or IV will be always systemic. There are some which can be given by inhalers. Now there will be, in near future, you will have some antibiotic available which will have a systemic effect by using inhalers. Depending upon the distribution and depending upon MIC and half-life, the antibiotic will remain in the blood. Half-life is the 50% of antibiotic is metabolized and the level remains 50%, and that we call as a half-life. So shorter the half-life, the antibiotic remains for short period in blood. Longer the half-life, the antibiotic will remain for a longer period in blood, having its effect. Hence, the antibiotic with a longer half-life are better because they will be acting for a longer period, and the required dose will be once in a day or twice in a day. But the antibiotic which is having a short half-life will have to give 2 times, 3 times, 4 times in a day. And antibiotic which is effective, it is called minimal inhibitory concentration. The lower the minimal inhibitory concentration, the antibiotic side effects and toxicity will be less. Higher the MIC level required for antibiotic to have its action, it will be having more toxicity, more side effects and dangerous. The antibiotic which is distributed in almost all fluids, all cells, is the best antibiotic. But the antibiotic which is distributed in a selective cells or selective fluids will be useful only in a selective condition. Say antibiotic which is concentrated only in urine will be utilized only in urinary tract infection. It will not be useful in other infections. Say very simple example, nitrofurantoin. Nitrofurantoin will be concentrated mainly in urine, but it is not available in respiratory tract. It is not available in CNS. It is not available in abdominal infection, etc. So it is utilized mainly, nitrofurantoin will be utilized mainly in urinary tract infection. One example I am giving of that. Almost majority of the antibiotics are metabolized by liver. Some antibiotics are metabolized 50% by liver and then thrown out by kidney. So two organs are required for metabolism. One for metabolism means antibiotic is converted into an inactive compound or maybe an inactive metabolic compounds by liver and then finally thrown out by either by GI tract or by liver. So metabolized by liver and then excreted in bile or maybe excreted by kidney in urine and sometime maybe thrown out in milk. So antibiotic products which are thrown out in milk, some product may be toxic to the feeding baby. So you have to keep that thing in mind. But some antibiotics which are thrown out by urine, in case of AKI and CKD, you will have to think over and decide whether to use or not. And if you have to use, you will have to cut down the dose depending upon the GFR. So metabolic products after metabolism may be active, may be inactive. Inactive metabolic products may be toxic, and active metabolites are useful because they are still active even after the metabolism. The side effect, the most common side effects when given orally are GI tract side effects. So common GI tract side effects like nausea, vomiting, GI upsets, etc. Some of the antibiotic will have a side effects on muscles, skin, those particular structures. On a skin, very common photosensitivity or allergic manifestation. Why? On a liver, we call hepatotoxic, nephrotoxic, ototoxic, neurotoxic, and they can be also dangerous to the fetus. So we call as person during pregnancy, you should not use those particular antibiotic. And some antibiotic produces a very dangerous side effects and severe side effects, and they are acute, like SJ syndrome, Stevens-Johnson syndrome. JH is Jerix-Herxheimer reaction. This will be in a person with a syphilis. This is with use of penicillin, sulfa, aspirin, etc. Or sometimes you can get even severe anaphylaxis. And in case of leprosy, while treating leprosy, you can get a lepra reaction. So these are there. And food, depending upon the type of the food and material also, some antibiotic absorption is increased. So that is beneficial effect. And some antibiotic absorption is becoming poor. So that is not a good effect. So antibiotic level in the blood, MIC level, will not reach. So those antibiotics should be taken on an empty stomach. So you have to keep it in mind which antibiotic has to be taken on empty stomach, which antibiotic can be taken after food. some antibiotic has got a photosensitivity, so after taking those antibiotic, person should not be exposed directly to the sunlight. He has to use a cap or a mouth cover, face cover, or he has to use sun lotion creams. Some antibiotic needs excess of fluid because they will be thrown out by urine, and if they are thrown out in larger concentration, they can produce crystal urea and then can produce nephrotoxicity. Some antibiotics should not be taken with antacids because absorption of those antibiotics can be interfered by antacids. So all this you have to keep it in mind. And we'll be talking about those as we come across with different antibiotics. Hydrophilic antibiotic will be concentrated highly in any fluid, cavity, etc. So this will be very useful in person having a pleural cavity infection, pericardial sac, abdominal cavity, meningitis, etc. And some antibiotics are what we call as lipophilic. So they will be concentrated highly in organs and intracellular. So they will be highly effective in a person who is having, say, amoebic liver pyogenic liver abscess, splenic abscess, pneumonia, etc. Some examples. So in those conditions, lipophilic antibiotic will be useful. And in a person with a serous cavity infections, we'll have hydrophilic antibiotic will be very useful. When you give oral, the antibiotic level rises this way. Slow rise and slow fall. While in intramuscular injection, little slow and higher rise, and then there is a gradual fall. While in an intravenous, there is a sharp rise, and then the level is maintained depending upon the metabolism, whether rapidly metabolized or slow metabolized, level will remain in the blood. So best way is intravenous to maintain the MIC level for a longer period. Here MIC level may not be maintained for a longer period. Here also MIC level may not be maintained because MIC level you will get during only this period. Here MIC level you will get during this period. Here you can get right from here till this level is maintained. So MIC level should be maintained. Now I am giving an example which can be taken with food, which should be taken on an empty stomach, which should be after taking that avoid exposure, along with which you should take plenty of fluids, and which antibiotic you should avoid with antacids. So to reduce the gastric side effects, antibiotics should be taken after meal. Sulfonamide, you can take it with food. And also azithromycin, erythromycin, you can take with food. But at the same time, rifampicin has to be taken purely on empty stomach. Azithromycin ideally should be taken between the two meals on an empty stomach. Erythromycin also has to be taken on an empty stomach. But because of lot of GI side effects, they are taken with food. But ideally, if person can tolerate, give it on empty stomach. Penicillin is also given on empty stomach. Remember, rifampicin has to be given on empty stomach, never with food. But azithromycin, you can decide depending upon the GI side effects. Penicillin and cephalosporin has got photosensitivity. So once you give that, the person who is having a photosensitivity should avoid exposure to the sunlight. Even sulfonamides can have a photosensitivity. And fluoroquinolones. Out of these, the most common we utilize cephalosporin and fluoroquinolones. Sulfonamides is not commonly utilized. So remember, certain cephalosporin has got photosensitivity and fluoroquinolones has also got a photosensitivity. So person who is having a photosensitivity, they should not be exposed to sun after taking this antibiotic. Even tetracycline can have a photosensitivity. When you take sulfonamides, the crystals of sulfonamides can be thrown out in urine and they can give rise to crystal urea and can produce damage to kidney. So they have to be taken with plenty of fluids. So whenever sulfonamide is given, give it along with plenty of fluids to prevent crystallization. And macrolides should not be given with what we call as antacids. So these are macrolides. Azithromycin, etc. should not be given. So person may not be aware of. Even quinolones should be avoided along with antacids. So these two antibiotics should not be taken. Even tetracycline should not be taken with antacids. So remember those three. And certain specific material. So whenever you want to take the some antibiotics or antifungal drugs, which will be rapidly absorbed with fat containing material like milk, curd, etc. So antifungal drugs should be taken with milk or what we call as curd, buttermilk, etc. Now this is one small slide which tells you that all these antibiotics are very nicely absorbed. So they can be given oral and you can reach what we call as an MIC level. There are some which are not very nicely absorbed, bad or variable, like penicillin, cephalosporin, erythromycin. Hence, this you have to keep it in mind. So whenever these antibiotics are given, you have to think of whether the level will be reached or not. And there are some which will never be absorbed. So these are called ugly. So aminoglycosides, vancomycin will not be absorbed for oral cavity. So this cannot be given orally at all. So these are the antibiotics which are mainly available in the form of injectables. And these are some of the antibiotics which can be utilized for what we call as a GI preparations before what we call as some procedures or even in a case of a hepatic encephalopathy. You can utilize aminoglycoside orally or you can use what we call as any aminoglycoside you can give orally. Particularly neomycin is very commonly utilized for hepatic encephalopathy. So these are considered as best oral antibiotics. Best oral antibiotics. So think it of this. So these are very rapidly absorbed. So they can be utilized. Ciprofloxacillin, clindamycin, chloramphenicol, sulfonamides, etc. While penicillin, cephalosporin, some are absorbed nicely, some are not absorbed nicely, and erythromycin particularly can be not available very nicely when they are given orally, depending upon certain factors. So a good antibiotic is an antibiotic which can be absorbed orally, which can be given intramuscular IV. So those are called good antibiotic. While the antibiotic which are not absorbed orally will be utilized for local purpose. For local purpose only. Like this. For local purpose. Or they can be utilized for systemic purpose if they are given intramuscular or IV. So, oral preparation can be acting locally as well as systemic. While the drugs which are not absorbed will be may be available for acting locally only, but not for systemic. And for systemic, you will have to give intramuscular or IV if they can be given. Ugly, what we call as they are poorly absorbed, so they are orally available, orally. When given orally, so they will be locally available. And for systemic effect, you will have to give intramuscular or IV. After absorption, either from oral, skin, nasal, lung, intramuscular or IV, they have to pass through liver and they will be metabolized by liver. Some antibiotics which are not absorbed, they will be topically available like skin, eye, ear ointment, drops, mainly neosporin and sofromycin. So these are that. And the antibiotic which are not absorbed from GI tract like neomycin, streptomycin, fraymycetin, mainly neomycin is utilized for GI preparation, particularly in a person with hepatic encephalopathy or person who is undergoing some GI procedure like surgery. Before undergoing a colonic surgery, you have to have a GI preparation. And for that, neomycin is most commonly being utilized for colonic preparation, preoperative preparations before surgery and also in case of hepatic coma. So that is particularly utilized. And if you want to utilize streptomycin for systemic purpose, it has to be given intramuscular. And if you want to utilize other what we call as aminoglycoside for bactericidal action on a gram-negative organism. It has to be given intramuscular or IV. So oral preparations are in the form of tablet, capsule, syrup, suspension, etc. And parenteral preparations are intramuscular IV. Some preparations are also available for intra-articular, intrathecal, etc. So intramuscular or intravenous routes, mainly IV routes, is utilized for severe infection, sepsis, CNS infection, cardiovascular system infection like infective endocarditis. In those conditions, IV route is preferred. Intramuscular route should not be given in a person who is having a shock stage or who has got a less muscle mass. In those people, intramuscular should not be given. IV should be preferred. Distribution-wise, you have to decide which antibiotic is distributed where. Some antibiotics are distributed in a wide variety of organs as well as fluid, say like penicillin. Penicillin will be available in brain, CSF, skin, lung, urinary tract, cardiovascular system. So it is a broad spectrum. Actually, it is a slightly broad spectrum and also available in many. So it will be a drug of choice in many diseases, CNS disease, pneumonias, urinary tract infection, infective endocarditis, skin conditions, etc. Also in case of sexually transmitted disease, all those conditions. Amoxicillin is also distributed in wide variety. While doxycycline is available in very few areas, skin and respiratory tract. It is not available in CNS, kidney, cardiovascular system. So you cannot use it like doxycycline in these groups. Cephalosporin is available in almost all fluids and all organs. So it can be utilized everywhere. Carbapenem also everywhere. Macrolides is mainly available in respiratory tract and skin. So it will be utilized mainly again like doxycycline. And it is not available for brain, kidney, cardiovascular system, those particular structures. MIC level is very, very important. You have to reach a minimum level for mild infection. But in severe infection, you require a little high MIC level. So you might have to give a little higher dose. And that should be sustained for a longer period. So higher the dose, the toxicity will be more. We have already told you regarding the metabolism, some antibiotics are not absorbed from GI tract. Hence, they will be directly thrown out in stool. Majority of the antibiotics are metabolized by liver and excreted by liver and kidney. That is excreted in a bile and by kidney. So you have to have two organs which should be in a good condition. Normal liver, normal kidney. Any person who has got a damaged liver, maybe an acute damage or a chronic damage, or even in the same thing in a kidney, AKI or a CKD, you have to think about the antibiotic effectiveness, toxicity, how much to give, etc. Some antibiotics are rapidly metabolized. So we call short-acting. Short-acting antibiotics you will have to give multiple times in a day. While slowly metabolized products, MIC level will be maintained for a longer period. So you will have to give for a less number of time in a day. So antibiotic with a short half-life, you have to give 4 times in a day. With a longer half-life, you might have to give only OD. So some majority of the antibiotics are metabolized by liver and thrown out by liver in bile and by kidney, or sometimes both by liver as well as kidney. And that's why that excretory product may be active metabolites or inactive. Inactive may be toxic, but active metabolite is useful. So you have to think from that point of view. So I'm giving some example, some antibiotics which are excreted by kidney, particularly penicillin and cephalosporin, while which is thrown out by kidney as well as liver, aminoglycoside, tetracycline, sulfonamides, all this. So this group of antibiotics should not be given with kidney and liver disease. Some antibiotics are metabolized by liver primarily. So this antibiotic should not be given if a person has got a liver damage, particularly rifampicin, isonex, metronidazole, linidazole, erythromycin, clindamycin, doxycycline, etc. So these are some of the antibiotics which should not be given in a liver damage. So these are contraindicated in CKD. These are contraindicated in liver damage, chronic liver damage, acute liver damage also. But this will be contraindicated if there is any kidney damage. So you have to decide depending upon the status. Some antibiotic has got direct toxic effect on the liver. We call hepatotoxic. Those antibiotics should not be used in a person who has already got a liver damage, or should not be used in a larger dose to avoid hepatotoxicity. And the antibiotic which has got a nephrotoxicity, one simple example, rifampicin Isonex, is highly hepatotoxic. Why? What we call is aminoglycosides are nephrotoxic. So try to avoid those in a person with a renal disease, and drugs which are hepatotoxic, avoid them in a liver damage. Some crosses the placenta and can have a toxic effect on the fetus. Those we call category C and D should not be utilized as far as possible during pregnancy. And some antibiotics are secreted in the milk, should not be given to the mother because they will have a toxic effect on the newborns. So you have to decide. The best safe antibiotic which is even secreted in the milk is cephalosporin, which will have less side effects on a newborn. Some of the common side effects like diarrhea, bloating sensation, abdominal, these are GI tract side effects. Loss of appetite, person feels sick, skin rash, cough. But the antibiotic which produces life-threatening allergic reaction like penicillin, sulfa, sometimes some cephalosporin, we call beta-lactamase group. They can produce anaphylaxis, they can have a SJ syndrome. And when they are used in syphilis, particularly penicillin, can produce Jarrett-Sachs-Simon reaction. And when you use a drug for treatment of leprosy, they can produce lepra reaction. Those are life-threatening reactions. So you have to keep it in mind. Always keep it in mind, nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, hepatotoxicity, also neurotoxicity. Say like Isonex can produce neurotoxicity. We have already given the example of nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, again aminoglycosides. Can be ototoxic, nephrotoxic. Hepatotoxic, rifampicin, Isonex, one simple example. Minor side effects like GI tract side effects, skin, etc. can be tackled. Anaphylaxis, skin rash, fixed drug reaction. I already mentioned regarding SJ, Steven Johnson, Jarrett-Sachs-Simon, lepra reaction, anaphylaxis, all those you have to take care. So SJ syndrome, Jarrett-Sachs-Simon. Because of destruction of a microflora of GI tract, person can develop pseudomembranous colitis. This is a very dangerous one, very commonly seen in a clarithromycin. So do keep it in mind. And antibiotic inactivation and wrong use of antibiotics. Prolonged use of antibiotics, not proper selection of antibiotics, can produce resistance in a microorganism. And you can also have a cross resistance, and you will start developing what we call as a drug resistance microorganisms. And this drug resistance microorganism can produce a bad organism available in society, and also they will be very commonly involving in nosocomial infections when the person is hospitalized and some procedure is done. Cross allergic reaction is very common between penicillin and cephalosporin, cephalosporin and carbapenem, etc. So this will have a cross allergic reaction. Azotrinam can have a cross allergy with ceftazidime. Cephalosporin can have a disulfiram effect if it is combined with metronidazole. And this is what we call as like Entaboo's effect when you are treating in a person who wants to have alcohol stopping, person who wants to get rid of alcohol addiction. So in that particular, you use disulfiram. So that's why it is given a name, disulfiram reaction. So it is called Entaboo's effect. So person will start getting nausea, vomiting very commonly. In a ticarcillin, person can get a bleeding in a uremic patients. So these are some of the odd. These are what we call as an antibiotic, which should be, dose reduction should be there in a CKD. These are there which you should avoid in a case of a liver disease, like erythromycin, pyrazinamide, rifampicin, Isonex should be avoided. And if required, you will have to cut down the dose. You will have to cut down the dose, particularly of metronidazole, Isonex, and rifampicin. But erythromycin and pyrazinamide should be avoided in a person who is having a chronic liver disease, even tetracycline. These are the common which are being utilized in your everyday practice. P-fluoxacillin is outdated. While in a case of a renal damage, aminoglycoside absolutely contraindicated. It should be avoided. Another drug which should be avoided is ethambutol. Some of the cephalosporin. And you have to cut down the dose, particularly of metronidazole, meropenem, fluoroquinolones. All those doses should be cut down in a person with a CKD. You have to keep it in mind, you have to cut down those doses. And drugs should be avoided like naledixic acid, nitrofurantoin in a person with a severe CKD, tetracycline, those should be avoided. So keep that thing in mind. Antibiotic resistance is very common because of overprescription. Even a person who is having an person who does not need is given antibiotic for a long period, improper doses, etc. Overprescription. Person who is having a viral infection or person who is having a protozoal infection, you are giving an antibiotics. Overuse of antibiotics, particularly in a fish and farming, and they produce a multi-resistance organisms. Patient do not complete the full treatment. Patient is taking improper doses. When it's prescribed twice a day, thrice a day, he takes only once a day, alternate day, etc. Lack of hygiene. You will pass on those resistant microorganisms from one person to another person. Poor infection control from hospital and clinics because improper doses are given, underdosing are given, improper antibiotic is selected, and lack of newer antibiotics which are not available in markets. So to avoid this, we are the person we have to take care. So doctors should not have mistreatment, means the treatment should be proper. Main culprit is at the level of a doctor. We should avoid that. So antibiotics should be used proper. Why? You know that many doctors, the word utilized is quacks. They prescribe antibiotic in viral infection and the doses, the timings, how to take, etc. is never given an advice. They are given for improper timings or for a longer period, even when it is not required. And viral illness does not require antibiotic. So always remember that. While on the side of the patient, what patient thinks? Doctor are bound to prescribe antibiotics, so don't continue with antibiotics. And don't forget to take one of our antibiotic free of sample before you leave the hospital. And this is a very common thing. They believe that person has given a cheaper drugs, that's why I will not take it. Good number of times this is there. Now, what is on the patient side? Without a proper direction, the patient takes the drugs and they do not maintain the doses interval and complete the doses. They stop in between as soon as they feel better. These are the common things which will predispose to resistance. So infection is there, antimicrobial use is there, and when there is no proper use of antimicrobial, you get a resistance. And that antimicrobial resistance is now again going to produce infection. And this will be by a resistance antimicrobial, which will not be effective by, which will not be affected by routine microbial drugs. You will have to use the drugs which are effective on resistance microorganism. So to prevent that, this has to be avoided. And this can be avoided by personal hygiene. Here, effective diagnosis and effective treatment. If you want to prevent this resistant formation, optimize the use. Optimum dose, right person, right time, right dose, right route. and prevent this transmission to another person. So prevention of transmission, this is prevention of infection. So this is a very, very important cycle. There are a lot of resistance which are there. Penicillin resistant streptococcus pneumonia, multi-drug resistant streptococcal pneumonia, methicillin resistant staphylococcus aureus, community acquired MRSA, then healthcare acquired MRSA. MRSA is there, but again, that is community acquired and healthcare. Then vancomycin resistance, vancomycin glycopeptide intermediate staphylococcus aureus group, vancomycin glycopeptide resistance enterococci. So these are lot of organisms which are there, and this will be there to produce infection in a new person or also in a person who is hospitalized. We call nosocomial infection. So those microorganisms which are resistant to multiple antibiotics, we call superbugs. And there are 12 steps to prevent antimicrobial resistance. Vaccinate, get catheter out as early as possible, target the pathogens, assess the experts, practical antibiotic controls, you get a local data, treat the infection, not the contamination, treat the infection, not a colonization, when to say no to the vancomycin, stop treatment when the person is cured, isolate the pathogens and contains your contagious person. And to prevent the transmission, use antimicrobial diagnostic test effectively and prevent infections. And the simple most way to prevent the transmission from one person to another person is personal hygiene. This is the best way. Hand washing reduces spread of antibiotic resistant strain. And this is by a doctor. He will get from an infected person and he'll transmit to another person. So this is the best way. So that will be there. Now we are going through indication, doses, routes, etc. Always remember, antibiotic is a dangerous weapon. It is a chemical weapon. Now we are going through one by one antibiotic groups. First group is beta-lactamase antibiotic groups. This is penicillin, cephalosporin, monobactams, and carbapenem. All these four groups, they are common under beta-lactamase antibiotics. Now penicillin, we will have natural penicillin, beta-lactamase resistant penicillins, aminopenicillin, which are very commonly now utilized in your everyday practice. We have got a carboxypenicillin, ticarcillin, not commonly utilized. We have got another, we call it the piperacillin. These are not commonly being utilized. These are utilized when these drugs are not effective. So we have got a natural penicillin, beta-lactamase resistant penicillin, methicillin. We have got aminopenicillin, which are very, very commonly now being utilized. And these are the two other groups. They are available in parenteral way and oral agents. Parenteral agents, which are available in intramuscular and IV preparations. They are available in natural variety, aminopenicillin, combination with beta-lactamase inhibitors like sulbactam, tazobactam, and we call clavulanic acid. These are the three beta-lactamase inhibitors. Or you can have an extended spectrum penicillins, which are called piperacillin, this uridopenicillin, piperacillin, ticarcillin, these two groups. Or we can have a extended spectrum penicillin with beta-lactamase inhibitor. These are all permutation combination available, depending upon where you want to use. Just in short an idea, penicillin is best effective in gram-positive. Some cases of gram-negative organisms, anaerobes, very, very effective, particularly all Clostridium group. They are not effective on atypical organism. They are also effective on spirochetes. They are not effective on mycobacterium. They are not effective on a nosocomial infection, which are gram-negative like Pseudomonas, etc. So you cannot utilize in a Pseudomonas infection, Pseudomonas, Klebsiella, all those infections. As penicillin is concentrated in skin, kidney, upper respiratory tract, lower respiratory tract, So mainly it is utilized for skin and lower and upper respiratory tract infection. They are not concentrated in bone, so cannot be utilized in bone infection. Even if it is gram positive, gram negative, in those cases you cannot utilize penicillin. So you cannot utilize them in a bone, urinary tract, liver, abdomen, etc. So best is in skin and soft tissue, respiratory tract infections. So you can utilize in gram positive organisms, staphylococci, streptococci, Neisseria meningitis, Clostridium, that is tetani, Welchi, that is gas gangrene, best drug of choice. Even in botulism, it is a drug of choice. You can utilize in syphilis. You can utilize them also in case of CNS infection, because this is also concentrated in CNS, brain. Side effects wise, it has got side effects mainly in a form of Jerich-Herzheimer reaction. On a blood, it can have a little small number of side effects. Now, this particular drug can be utilized in cardiovascular system because it is concentrated in blood and it is utilized in infective endocarditis. It is also utilized in meningitis. So, particularly in a gram-negative organism, Neisseria meningitis, it is a drug of choice. So, indication is skin and soft tissue, respiratory tract infection, Neisseria meningitis, infective endocarditis. Also in an infective endocarditis, it is utilized as prophylaxis. And non-bacterial infections like syphilis, it is one of the drug of choice. So this is in short regarding penicillin. Side effect of penicillin, giddiness, person can have fever. Because of penicillin itself, we call drug-induced fever. Person can have a headache, nausea. Skin rash is quite common with penicillin. You can have angioedema, you can develop diarrhea, and you can have anaphylaxis. And in anaphylaxis, you develop an angioedema, bronchospasm, tightening of lungs, etc. And this can be a dangerous one. And sometimes person can collapse also, and person can die. So among adverse side effects, fever, vomiting, diarrhea, rashes, erythema, dermatitis, angioedema, nausea, etc. And among the dangerous side effects, anaphylaxis, and we call Jerich-Herzheimer reaction when you give it to a person with syphilis. So penicillin can be utilized in pneumococcal pneumonia, also in a Staphylococcus aureus, Streptococcus pneumonia, Streptococcus viridans. In Listeria, you can utilize that. In a Cornibacterium diphtheria also it can be utilized. Bacillus anthracis also Listeria. Neisseria gonorrhea you can utilize. You can utilize also in Neisseria meningitis. In a syphilis, Trypanema pallidum you can utilize. In a Leptospira also you can utilize. So these are some of the conditions where you can utilize. Meningitis, infective endocarditis, Leptospira, pneumonias, tetanus, anthrax, diphtheria, Listeria, gas gangrene, and also in case of gonorrhea. All these are different conditions, and even in syphilis. So do remember, it is a very good drug, but before giving a drug, you must do a test dose to prevent anaphylaxis. And test dose is to be given intradermal. This also belongs to the same group of penicillin. This is a little broad spectrum, ampicillin or amoxicillin. It is effective on gram-positive, gram-negative organism and even on anaerobes. But not effective on atypical organism, mycobacterium or nosocomial. So it is not effective for nosocomial infection on or what we call the tuberculosis. It cannot be utilized. In a sexually transmitted disease, it is effective. Particularly in what we call as gonorrhea, in syphilis, etc. But not commonly utilized. It is concentrated in almost good number of fluids. So skin, soft tissue, bones, URTI, LRTI, UTI, liver, abdomen, gynec, cardiovascular, CNS, pregnancy, CKD, AKI. In those conditions also you can utilize, but those you will have to cut down jaundice patient also, in a liver damage also you can utilize, and even in an old person. So this is considered as a best antibiotic which can be given orally, intramuscular or parenteral, any. But because of GI side effect, when given orally, slightly contraindicated, or you've got a less indications. Particularly person is prone to get nausea, vomiting and diarrhea. As far as kidney is concerned, not much amount of side effects. Liver, not much amount of side effects. In a blood, you can have a little amount of a side effects, but not very common. You can get a resistance very fast when you use alone amoxicillin or ampicillin, and when the dose is not utilized properly. So the antibiotic resistance is very, very common. Hence, amoxicillin and ampicillin should not be utilized alone. By and large, it is combined with clavulanic acid or with sulbactam. So I'll show you this slide again. So it is effective on gram-positive, gram-negative and anaerobes. So any one of these three infections you can utilize, and any tissue, skin, bone, respiratory, urinary tract, abdominal organs, cardiovascular, CNS, etc. But whenever you want to use for cardiovascular, CNS and abdominal, it should be utilized in the form of injectables. And by and large, always try to utilize along with clavulanic acid or sulbactam, because these are beta-lactamase inhibitors. And being that, amoxicillin, ampicillin will be more effective. And you can utilize them in peritonitis, in a typhoid fever, pneumonias, meningitis, H. pylori infections, etc. So this is the main use of amoxicillin clavulanic acid. And as it is available in almost all organs and all fluids, it can be utilized in almost all different system in infection. Beta-lactamase inhibitors is usually not used alone. It is always in combination. And with combination, it is very effective on gram-positive, gram-negative, anaerobes, and also it will be effective on atypical organisms. So this is the major advantage. And it is concentrated in almost all fluids. Skin, soft tissue, bones, respiratory tract, urinary tract, abdomen, CVS, CNS, even it will be available in pregnancy. It is safe. Even in jaundice, etc. Yes, you might have to cut down the dose little bit. But as far as side effect is concerned, mainly GI tract side effects is there. Otherwise, there is a minor drug reactions. Otherwise, not a major contraindication. So in combination, there are three materials: sulbactam, tazobactam, or clavulanic acid. Sorry, A is missing here. Clavulanic acid. So that is what we call the beta-lactamase inhibitors. And they are always to be utilized in combination with either cephalosporin or in combination with what we call as aminopenicillins, amoxicillin or ampicillin. These are the two major. Also, it is combined good number of time with piperacillin. That is, we call as other groups. So it can be combined with piperacillin or ticarcillin. Mainly it is combined with piperacillin. And this is Pseudomonas. So this drug is having an additional advantage of action against Pseudomonas infection. And Pseudomonas infection is very common in a nosocomia. So it is very, very effective on a gram-negative microorganisms, and particularly Pseudomonas. So ticarcillin with clavulanic acid or piperacillin with tazobactam is very, very effective on a Pseudomonas infections. So mainly used in nosocomial infections. Now we come to the second big group, we call cephalosporin. But these are also beta-lactamase inhibitors. In cephalosporin, we have got a first generation, second generation, third generation, fourth generation, and now we have got a fifth generation also. First generation, remember, gram-positive only. Second and third generation, gram-positive and gram-negative. Third generation becomes more effective on gram-positive. Less effective on gram-negative, but less effective on gram-positive. As you go to fourth generation now, fourth generation is very effective on gram-positive as well as gram-negative. More on gram-negative, less on gram-positive. And fifth generation is only in IV form, and it is effective mainly on gram-negative, less on gram-positive. So these are the fourth generation. Some are available in parenteral, some are available in oral. This is first generation. Parenteral preparations are cefazolin, mainly, which is commonly utilized, while orally cefalexin, cefadroxin. These are two commonly utilized in our markets. So oral preparation, cefadroxin and cefalexin, while injectable is cefazolin. While second generation, parenteral preparation is ciforaxime, while oral preparation is ciforaxime and cefaclor. While third generation, which is most commonly utilized, oral is cefexime, while injectable is cefotaxime, cefoparazone, ceftriaxone, etc. These are the common preparations which is, this is the most commonly utilized, because this is very, very effective on gram negative and also effective on gram positive organism. While fourth generation, mainly available in parenteral preparation, is cefepime and cefaparone. These are mainly utilized for what we call as the abdominal infections and resistant beta lactamase organisms. So remember that this is the most commonly utilized, and it is available in parenteral as well as oral. So usually you utilize parenteral and switch over to oral, that is cefixime. So that is the way. The parenteral preparation of this is not available in oral form. So remember that you don't have cefuroxime. You got a cefuroxime available as parenteral and cefuroxime available as oral also. This is also equally effective, but more effective on gram positive and little effect on a gram negative. But this is more on gram negative, less on gram positive. So this will be very useful in a abdominal infection, renal infections, etc., which are more gram negative than gram positives. So simultaneously I'm mentioning in which condition they will be more effective. So first generation, second generation is for gram positive. Why? Gram negative if it is there, third and fourth generation. So always prefer for gram negative, third generation and fourth generation. And for gram positive, first and second generation. But if you've got both gram negative as well as gram positive possibility, always use a third generation. Don't use a second generation. As far as possible, use a third generation. If you've got a gram positive and gram negative, second, third and fourth generation. Okay. And fourth generation is only for nosocomial. And fifth generation now is only available in parenteral is ceftobiprole. So this is now available. And you can go through this all different material which is available. Cefuroxime is only available in parenteral and oral preparation. While third generation, you give parenteral either in the form of cefotaxime or ceftriaxone. And then when you switch over to oral, usually we use cefixime, that is commonly being utilized. So that will be the way. Now the common use, skin, you can use in meningitis, pneumonias, etc. Adverse side effect, you can have a disulfiram effect when utilized with metronidazole. You can have a nephrotoxicity. It can give rise to thrombocytopenia, bleeding tendency. You can have an allergic reactions like anaphylaxis. You can have a phlebitis when it is given IV. So remember, first generation more on gram positive. Second generation, gram positive, gram negative. Third and fourth generation more on gram negative, less on gram positive. But fourth generation has got also effect on gram positive also. So depending upon that, you will have to select. I've already mentioned everything. Again, this is one antibiotic which is concentrated in majority of the fluids. So it can be utilized in almost all. First generation, you cannot utilize in cardiovascular and CNS because it is not concentrated there. But second generation, very well concentrated. So third generation is concentrated everywhere. You can utilize in gram positive and gram negative organisms. Also, it is also effective in some of the nosocomial, particularly the fourth generation is more effective. So the fourth generation will be of a choice in those particular groups. So fourth generation will be the main choice for nosocomial infections. So this is regarding a cephalosporin. And fifth generation is mainly available in the form of injectable. We call ceftobiprole. And this is useful in methicillin resistance and penicillin resistance. staphylococci and streptococci. Now you've got another group we call as a monobactam group, and one of the compound is estrionom, and another group we call as a carbapenem, where imipenem, meropenem, doripenem, ertapenem, etc. are available. Monobactam, usually what we call as a estrionom, will be mainly for gram-negative, mainly for gram-negative, and for nosocomial. It is concentrated in good number of tissue, so can be utilized in any one of this. And then that particular drug is having one side effects, that is a rash, and is very effective in gram-negative organism, particularly pseudomonas. So you can utilize in a nosocomial infections. So monobactam will become a drug of choice in a person with abdominal infections and nosocomial infections, where pseudomonas infection is quite common. Carbapenem is effective in gram-positive, gram-negative, anaerobes, and nosocomial. It is concentrated in almost all fluids. So it is utilized very commonly in, by and large, abdominal infection, lower respiratory tract, urinary tract, CNS, CVS, etc. But lot of GI side effects, little nephrotoxicity, little effect on blood, and also has got cardiovascular side effects. And there is also a little side effect during pregnancy. So in those particular conditions, you will have to use with caution. It is very effective on gram-negative as well as gram-positive and anaerobes. So very useful in septicemia. Very, very useful in septicemia. And also in case of nosocomial infections. Now we come to another big groups, most commonly utilized in your everyday practice. Very, very commonly utilized in multiple different conditions, we call as a quinolones, or also we call as a fluoroquinolones. The original quinolones, which was first being marketed, was nalidixic acid. Now this is outdated. Then came different fluoroquinolones. First generation, and then we came across second, third, and fourth generation. These are called as a new generation. The first generation was ciprofloxacillin, norfloxacillin, P, and ofloxacillin. Now, out of this, only norfloxacillin is utilized in market, and mainly it is utilized for GI tract and for urinary tract. It is not for other infections. It is not utilized for respiratory or any other infection because it is not concentrated there. Now, the most commonly which are utilized is second generation, that is levofloxacillin. The third generation, among those, moxifloxacillin, and fourth generation are yet not being utilized commonly, and they are not commonly freely available in markets. So commonly we utilize moxifloxacillin for MDR tuberculosis, very commonly used, and levofloxacillin at present is most commonly utilized in your everyday practice. So we'll be talking about all those compounds. This first generation, that is ciprofloxacillin, was very, very effective on what we called as that ciprofloxacillin, ofloxacillin, which we consider ofloxacillin from second generation, was very effective on E. coli, Proteus, and Pseudomonas. So this is one drug which is not now being utilized very commonly because of good number of side effects, particularly on a QT prolongations. And hence, this drug is sometimes very good and effective on a Pseudomonas infection. Can be utilized, but if utilized properly. So can be used in those particular conditions. And also in an E. coli and Proteus infection. While moxifloxacillin, that is third generation and fourth generation groups. Now gatifloxacillin is outdated because of the QT prolongation. But it is superior because it is very effective on a gram-positive organism, enterococcus, anaerobic infections, and atypical organism, particularly chlamydia and mycoplasma. And this is very common in respiratory tract. So in atypical pneumonias, this moxifloxacillin becomes a drug of choice. And also what we call as a third generation, that is moxifloxacillin, becomes a drug of choice. While gatifloxacillin is nearly outdated. So that is the type of the use. So lot of effects, It can be utilized in a nosocomial infection because it is effective on Klebsiella, Pseudomonas, Enterococci, Shigella, etc. So it is one of the drugs utilized in nosocomial infections. It is also effective for Mycobacterium. So it is utilized also in MDR tuberculosis. Neisseria gonorrhea also it is effective. So it is utilized in sexually transmitted disease, particularly in case of gonorrhea. In lower respiratory tract infection, it is also very, very effective. In enteric fever also, it can be utilized. In urinary tract infection also, it is very, very effective. And particularly, norfloxacillin is good and very effective. And as it is not commonly utilized, you don't have a resistance to these particular microorganisms. You don't have a resistance. So fluoroquinolones is very effective in gram-positive, gram-negative. It is also effective on some of the anaerobes. It is very, very effective in atypical organisms. Particularly, we have already mentioned what we call as atypical organisms like Legionella, even Then in sexually transmitted disease also it is effective. Particularly fluoroquinolones, that is moxifloxacillin, is very useful now in a atypical array, Mycobacterium tuberculosis, particularly drug resistant Mycobacterium. And also it is effective on Pseudomonas. So it is effective also in a nosocomial infections, but has got lot of GI tract side effects, nephrotoxicity, hepatotoxic. There are little side effects on the blood, particularly it can produce thrombocytopenia, QT prolongation, particularly very common in a gatifloxacillin. It has got a skin manifestation, bone. All this becomes a little drawback for fluoroquinolones. And it is absolute contraindication in pregnancy. Remember that. We come to another group, we call it macrolides. Macrolides, again we call azithromycin, erythromycin and clarithromycin. These are the three macrolides which are being there. They are effective on gram-positive, gram-negative, anaerobes, and very effective on atypical organisms. Also effective on what we call as a spirochetes, particularly Trypanema pallidum, and also in case of gonorrhea also. It is also effective for Mycobacterium and may be slightly useful in case of a nosocomial infections. So macrolide is useful in all those different organisms. Why? There are very few side effects, particularly GI tract side effects, and little hepatotoxicity, particularly with erythromycin. So erythromycin is contraindicated in a person with a hepatotoxicity. It will be effective on a skin, soft tissue, upper respiratory, lower respiratory tract. In pregnancy, it should not be utilized because there are some side effects on a fetus. Also in a liver disease, it should not be utilized. So these are some of the things which where macrolides should be utilized with caution. So one another things, the macrolides is very, very useful in atypical organism, MDR tuberculosis, STI, enteric fever, it can be useful. So these are some of the utilization of macrolides in STI, particularly syphilis, atypical organism. You can be utilizing that like chlamydia, mycoplasma, legionella, those particular organisms. In a chlamydia infection also it can utilize legionella disorders, particularly legionella pneumonias, mycoplasma pneumonias, you can utilize. You can utilize in a Cornibacterium diphtheria. You can utilize in STI, URTI, even in LRTI, particularly pneumonias. You've got clarithromycin, azithromycin. Azithromycin can be a drug of choice in all these conditions, and clarithromycin is having all these conditions. And there's an additional advantage of clarithromycin that it can be utilized also in case of H. pylori infections. Now we come to another which is now almost gone out of market, but wonderful drugs. We call sulfonamides, and good number of times sulfonamide is combined with trimethoprim. It is effective on gram-positive, gram-negative organisms, atypical organism, trachoma, nocardia. It is also useful in resistant malaria and P. falciparum when combined with what we call as trimethoprim. Now, this particular antibiotic is available in a high concentration in UTI, urinary tract. So can be utilized in urinary tract infections. Also available in upper respiratory tract. So can be utilized in upper respiratory tract infection also. So in these two conditions, very frequently being utilized. And one of the major, it can produce anaphylaxis, and we call Stevens-Johnson syndrome, SJ syndrome. So do keep it in mind. And some minor side effects in cardiovascular system. It has got little side effects on GI tract, and in kidney, it can produce crystallurea of sulfonamides and can produce renal damage. And to avoid renal damage, you will have to give plenty of fluids when you give sulfonamides, and should not be used during pregnancy because of side effects on fetus, particularly of trimethoprim. It is a drug of choice in resistant malaria, particularly P. falciparum and all resistant malaria. It can be utilized in UTI, very, very effective. In URTI, skin and soft tissue infections also. In trachoma, very, very good drug. Always keep it in mind of SJ syndrome. Ask a person whether he is having any reaction to sulfa. And if not, and if you want to use, always give a small dose of sulfonamide, wait for a while, and then give a second dose. Don't give the entire dose of sulfonamides together to avoid SJ syndrome. Once in a while, you can come across SJ syndrome. It is sometimes utilized in sexually transmitted disease. Also, it is wonderfully effective in enteric fever, but because of this risk, GI tract, renal, blood, etc., the use is little bit reduced. So it is utilized in a topical use, particularly in the form of burns, in a case of burns, wounds, for topical dressings, nocardiasis, urinary tract infections, particularly E. coli and Proteus. In trachoma, very, very effective. Very, very effective. So wonderful drug for that. In combination with trimethoprim, it is very good for STI, LRTI, URTI, UTI. Very, very effective. So can be utilized in all these conditions. And also, it can be utilized in enteric fever. So LRTI, URTI, UTI, prostate, enteric fever, sexually transmitted disease, and atypical pneumonias. Skin and soft tissue also it can be utilized. So it is a drug of choice in combination with trimethoprim in all these conditions. Pneumocystic carinii, respiratory infections, genital infections, particularly Neisseria, gonorrhea, Neisseria meningitidis, prostatic infection and urinary tract infection by E. coli, Proteus. Even it is effective in GI tract like Salmonella typhi, Shigella, etc. And in case of respiratory tract, particularly atypical organism, Legionella, H. influenza, in those also it is effective. So it is a good drug, but should be used with caution. And usually we don't come across resistance to these particular organisms. but it is mainly bacteriostatic. But in combination with trimethoprim, it can be bactericidal also. Now another group, aminoglycosides, mainly available in form of injectable. This aminoglycoside is not absorbed from GI tract, so cannot be given orally for systemic effect. But it is utilized for GI tract, particularly for preoperative preparations. Whenever a person is doing a surgery on a colon, large bowel surgery, or in a hepatic coma, it is utilized for per oral. But in a case of a gram-negative organism infections, in a mycobacterium infections, particularly multi-drug resistance, amikacin and streptomycin is commonly utilized. This particular drug is mainly utilized for gram-negative organism, that is E. coli infections. It is highly concentrated in skin, bones, then lower respiratory tract, urinary tract, liver, abdomen, cardiovascular system, CNS, etc. As it is highly nephrotoxic, it should not be utilized in renal disorders like AKI, CKD, absolute contraindication. It is also having another toxicity like ototoxicity, and sometimes it can also have a damage to what we call as retina, and it should not be given in a pregnancy, during pregnancy. It is belonging to category C, so it should not be given in during pregnancy. It is a wonderful drug, should be used with caution. Again, I'm repeating, absolute contraindication in pregnancy, absolute contraindication in AKI and CKD, and major side effect, ototoxicity and nephrotoxicity. But wonderful drug for gram-negative organisms in abdominal system, cardiovascular system, CNS, urinary tract, liver, etc. Even in bone also. Amikacin is very, very commonly utilized, while streptomycin is commonly utilized for MDR tuberculosis, very, very common. So for Pseudomonas infections, MDR tuberculosis, sometime even in a nosocomial, because you come across gram-negative organisms, it has got ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and in pregnancy, absolute contraindication. If you get ototoxicity, nephrotoxicity, and during pregnancy, and in case of AKI and CKD, it is also utilized in UTI, meningitis, and certain pneumonias. You can combine with other drugs which are effective on gram-positive as well as gram-negative organism. So it is utilized for Pseudomonas infections. Topical preparations for skin, eye, ear, etc. So neomycin and phreomycetin is a drug from aminoglycosides. And Pseudomonas, chronic urinary tract infections, pneumonias, particularly by E. coli, Klebsiella, Proteus, Pseudomonas infection, Vibrio cholera, all those infections very well affected by aminoglycosides. And these are the drugs which are to be utilized. Gentamicin and amikacin is the most common drug which are utilized IV, and streptomycin is most commonly utilized in person with MDR tuberculosis. Neomycin and phreomycetin is utilized for local, and we call as neomycin is mainly for skin, eye, ear, those three, mainly in the form of drops, ointments, etc. And for skin, in the form of powder, ointment, lotions, all those conditions. Now regarding another antibiotic, so major which we are using in everyday practice, we have covered all those antibiotics. Now the major other antibiotics which we are going to discuss is tetracycline. Not commonly utilized, but one of the drugs which belongs to tetracycline group is doxycycline. It is slight effect on gram positive, on gram negative, also on anaerobes. Very effective on atypical organism, particularly mycoplasma and legionella. It is also effective in STD, sexually transmitted disorders, or sexually, I should have used STI, infections, particularly syphilis, gonorrhea. It is also effective on Lyme's disease. It is effective on chlamydia. Plus, this is doxycycline is also effective on malarial infections. Now, only drawback is GI tract side effects in the form of nausea, vomiting, loose motions, and it can produce pseudomembranous colitis. And it should not be given during pregnancy, major. It is also having a little side effects on liver. So you have to keep a watch on liver. So keep this thing particularly in mind. So now, the major use is for atypical pneumonias, mainly in the form of doxycycline it is utilized, STI, LRTI, URTI, most commonly utilized skin and soft tissue infections, Leptospira, it is also a drug of choice. In case of cholera, it is a drug of choice. It should not be utilized because of colitis, drawback, pregnancy, it is a drawback. In neonates also, it should not be utilized because it stains the teeth. Yellowish staining of the teeth will take place. Sorry here, I should have mentioned here. Doxycycline has got no effect on UTI. So it should not be utilized for UTI. Sorry, this should be separated out. It is very effective for sexually transmitted disease, so it is a drug of choice for STI and also in a case of chlamydia infections. They are available in two forms, natural salts like tetracycline, dimocycline. These are the two common compounds which are being utilized, and in the form of semi-synthetic, doxycycline and minocycline. These are the two common compounds which are available in markets. Doxycycline is effective on a big list of organisms. That's why it is also called as a broad spectrum organisms. Broad spectrum. And you are aware of it. This is oral. Now, even doxycycline is available in form of the injectables also. It is effective on gram-positive, gram-negative, spirochetes, mycoplasma, rickettsia, candida albicans, mycoplasma pneumonia, chlamydia, then borrelia, Yersinia, Vibrio cholera, Campylobacter vector, Brucella, Streptococcus pneumonia, Neisseria gonorrhea, so many organisms. So it is a very broad spectrum. And because of this, nowadays the use of doxycycline has increased like anything. So chlamydia infections, Lyme infections, cholera, mycoplasma pneumonia, Rocky Mountain spotted fevers, etc. That is rickettsial fever. So it is effective in lot number of these conditions. STI, atypical pneumonias, atypical organism. Even dimocycline is utilized in SIDH. Diabetes insipidus. And effusions. It is also utilized in certain effusions. H. pylori infection also it is utilized because of effect on atypical organisms. Contraindication, mainly it stains the teeth. It is inactivated by calcium ions, so it should not be taken with milk, yogurt and dairy products. Also, it is not absorbed if it is taken with antacids. There is some amount of photosensitivity, so some person who has photosensitive should not expose to sunlight after taking a drug. It has got drug-induced hepatitis. It can produce fatty liver. It can produce lupus. And it may interfere with methotrexate. So a person who is on a methotrexate, and when you give tetracycline, it can interfere with methotrexate. Possible side effects, GI tract side effects, tongue, swollen tongue, itching. You can have a discharge, vaginal discharge, loss of appetite. You can have a hepatotoxic, jaundice can develop. You can have a skin manifestations. It is toxic during pregnancy. It stains teeth. It has got a renal damage, entamoebic effect, photosensitivity. Fanconi syndrome can happen, hypersensitivity, super infection like pseudomembranous colitis, vestibular toxicity can be there. All these are additional side effects. And these are dose related toxicity. So higher the dose, the chances of all these are there. Now we come to another compound which is very commonly utilized as an antibiotic, particularly in a gram negative. Basically, it is an effective for amoebiasis, trichomoniasis, and giardiasis. These are what we call as a protozoa. But it is effective on anaerobic organisms, gram negative anaerobic organisms. So it is a drug of choice. 100% it is absorbed from gut. It is well absorbed into abscess. That's why it is very commonly utilized in a gram negative organisms, particularly anaerobic organisms. Side effects, seizures, cerebellar dysfunctions, and pseudomembranous colitis. Out of this, the pseudomembranous colitis is more common than seizures and cerebellar dysfunctions. So it should not be utilized in a person with seizures. So keep that thing in mind. It is useful in amoebiasis, trichomonal infections, and giardiasis. This is the major indications and common use. But it is also utilized for anaerobic infections and H. pylori infections. So these are the two utilized for antibiotic purpose, antibacterial purpose we call. So spectrum wise, it is also effective on Fusobacterium, Clostridium, Campylobacterium, H. pylori, and also effective on spirochetes. So it can be utilized in any one of this. But the first use was in amoebiasis. And then came trichomonas. Trichomonas and amoebiasis. So that was the use. So metronidazole belongs to nitroimidazole group. Metronidazole, tinidazole, secnidazole, ornidazole. These are the four common compounds which are available in market and very commonly being utilized. And it has got disulfiram effects with alcohol. And also, that is disulfiram effect means when a person is on metronidazole and if a person takes alcohol, he will have nausea, vomiting, and abdominal discomfort. That is called disulfiram effects. And that has to be kept in mind. So this is one drug which is being utilized very, very commonly. Metronidazole, ornidazole, secnidazole, and tinidazole. These are the common drugs. Contraindication, person who is having an epilepsy in a blood dyscrasia should not be given during pregnancy, and person who is alcoholic. In this particular group, if a person takes alcohol along with that, he will have a severe nausea, vomiting, prostration, etc. We call disulfiram effects. And during pregnancy, it can have a teratogenic effects. Another group we call vancomycin group. It is also called methicillin resistance group. So vancomycin is very effective for MRSA. We call MRSA, methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, this group. But it has got little side effects on kidney, nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity when given with aminoglycosides. So as far as possible, it should be avoided along with aminoglycosides. And nowadays, we get vancomycin resistance organisms. So vancomycin resistance, Staph and Enterococcus. So it is called vancomycin resistance emergence. So that is now commonly seen. So whenever you use the vancomycin, keep it in mind. It is a reserved drug for MRSA. And person with an MRSA, when given, you have to keep a watch on nephrotoxicity, ototoxicity, and for emergence of VRE, vancomycin resistance E. coli. Then another group of drug we call lincosamide. This is clindamycin and lincomycin. These are effective on gram-positive and anaerobic organisms. And it has got a very good penetration in bone and abscess. Hence, it becomes a very good drug of choice for what we call as osteomyelitis, pyogenic arthritis, or on orthopedic surgeries. Side effects: lincomycin can produce pseudomembranous colitis, GI tract side effects, and hepatotoxicity. This drug is available in oral form as well as injectable forms, and it is a good drug of choice for orthopedic person. Lincosamide, we call lincomycin and clindamycin. So it is useful for methicillin susceptible Staphylococcus aureus, methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus MRSA, and also for Streptococcus pneumonia. Also person can develop streptococcal pneumonia, resistance is developing in this particular group. So pneumonia resistance. And it is also effective on T. condyle, and also can be used in malaria. This is outdated drug, but now it has come again in market, chloramphenicol. It is mainly reserved for typhoid fever. It is very, very notorious to produce a severe blood disorders we call agranulocytosis, pancytopenia, and agranulocytosis, and person dies because of complication because of agranulocytosis. It was the drug of choice for meningitis, and also meningitis due to H influenza. It was a drug of choice, but it was very commonly was utilized for typhoid fever. Nowadays, a person with enteric fever gets resistance to lot of antibiotics like amoxicillin, ampicillin. Also, person may be resistant to fluoroquinolones, and even sometime too, we call cephalosporin. In that particular group of resistance typhoid fever, you can utilize chloramphenicol, but always keep a watch on this blood disorders, agranulocytosis. That is very, very common. Nitrofurantoin was one of the drugs which was very good drug and has to be used with caution. It acts by inhibiting the protein synthesis. It is very, very effective on enterococcus and has been very commonly utilized mainly for lower urinary tract infection, particularly prostate and for bladder. But as nitrofurantoin is not concentrated much in prostate, it is not very commonly utilized for prostatic infection and not utilized for pyelonephritis also. Mainly now kept for, we call cystitis. So nitrofurantoin should be avoided in a chronic prostatic infections and should not be given as a drug in a case of a pyelonephritis. But it is very effective on a E. coli, enterococcus. So you should be aware of it. Rifampin, mainly utilized for tuberculosis, but now also it is utilized for H. influenza, Neisseria meningitis also. So keep this thing in mind. Rifampin is that particular drug. And now one of the another use is for GI tract infections. Sulfones, mainly available in the form of Dapsone. It is a drug of choice for leprosy. I'm skipping over this. Antibiotic in separate selective bacteria. These are the antibiotic for Pseudomonas, that is ciprofloxacin, gentamicin, piperacillin, ceftazidime, that is the third generation and fourth generation cephalosporin, meropenem, imipenem. For Staph aureus, cloxacillin, first generation cephalosporin, vancomycin. Here vancomycin is very commonly being utilized, linazolidine. Enterococci, very commonly ampicillin, amoxicillin, nitrofurantoin for lower respiratory tract, urinary tract, lower urinary tract. Linazolidine for VRE resistance, etc. H. influenza, amoxicillin, cephalosporin, second and third generation cephalosporin, levofloxacillin and moxifloxacillin. And for anaerobes, metronidazole, amoxicillin, clavulanic acid combination, piperacillin, tazobactam combination, etc. You have to think over what is the, by and large, if you go for a culture and antibiotic sensitivity, you will get these particular results. And depending upon that results, you can utilize. and also look for the resistance organisms. Now, these are all the newer antibiotics. I'm not going to talk anything regarding them. These are all indifferent. Oxazolidine, that is ridazolid and torazolid. Glycopeptides, in that glycopeptides, otavacin and delvavacin. Lipopeptides, deptomycin is already coming in markets. Ketolides, telithromycin, cetomycin, solithromycin, they are in trials and they are available now. Glycine, that is tigacycline, it is available. Carbapenems, ertapenems, doripenems, they are available now. Cephalosporin, newer cephalosporin are coming in market, they are in pipelines. You got carbacifem, these are different compounds, little different from cephalosporin. These are newer compounds like iclaprim compounds, near future they will be for use. These are pleuromutilins, macrocycline antibiotics, then rifamycin antibiotic, rifaximin, this is now available in market, mainly utilized for traveler diarrheas and hepatic encephalopathy. So our target should be, virulence factor should be targeted, it should be bactericidal, look at the host response and look at the microorganisms. These are antifungal drugs. I'm not going to talk anything regarding antifungal drugs. These are all antifungal drugs. They are all antiviral drugs. Now these are hot topics because we have got COVID infections. These are all different type of antiviral. Some antiviral drug is being utilized in COVID infection. I end my lecture here. We'll be taking on approach to fever and use of antibiotics in subsequent discussion. I think this will be very helpful to you. You can go through repeatedly. You will remember all those things and it will be very, very helpful to you. We'll see you in the next lecture.